All right, the music is off, so I think it's my cue to get started. Thank you for showing up, everybody. It's so exciting to come here. Last year I was here, and it was a small little conference. Mesos was still a very new technology, and only a couple of companies were using it. So it's really good to see the community having grown so much, and so many people doing and working with Mesos a lot. My name is Kan Gupta. I'm an engineering manager at Bloomberg. I work with a small startup team in Bloomberg called Bloomberg Vault. My background is primarily in intrusion detection, that was last life, anti-spam, text search, and distributed systems in general. So today I'm going to talk about the kind of problems that we solve at Bloomberg, specifically Bloomberg Vault, how Mesos helps us solve these problems, and the kind of things and infrastructure we had to build to take Mesos to production. If you are new to Mesos, if you're looking to, if you're thinking about running Mesos in production, you'll benefit by learning the kind of things you need to do to take bare Mesos and run it in production clusters. If you're curious to know how people are using Mesos, I always am, you learn something new. Or if you just want to use Bloomberg, just want to learn more about Bloomberg, you'll find some more things. Bloomberg is typically very secretive company. This little logo here, that's a Bloomberg terminal. It's the main platform that we have for delivering news, data, analytics to our customers. Most of our customers are our companies, big companies, banks in financial sector. It's also a platform that delivers a very low latency communication services to our customers. And we do this by the time when I joined Bloomberg, Bloomberg had like one of the largest, world's largest private networks. I don't know if that's still true, but it's still a very big private network. We deliver data and analytics to our customers, which essentially subscribe to Bloomberg terminals. So we have about 300,000 plus Bloomberg terminal subscribers. I want to start with a story that broke, that Wall Street Journal broke in 2008. Wall Street Journal reported that there are some banks are reporting flawed interest rate data for LIBOR. LIBOR, for those of you who don't know, is essentially the interest rate that the leading banks charge each other to borrow money, short-term money, right? Why should this matter to you? It's actually, if you have a home mortgage, any consumer loan, car loan, student loan, anything, LIBOR is used as the basis or the reference number to build those, to calculate what the interest rate on mortgage or all of the consumer loans is, right? So typically what they do is they'll take the LIBOR, that's the base rate, and add 3% to calculate what your mortgage is gonna be, right? So about $450 trillion worth of financial deals are dependent on LIBOR, and this number is not very, I don't know if it's completely accurate, but the range I've heard is between $300 and $500 trillion worth of deals, right? So it impacts a lot of financial deals. It's also kind of a measure of trust in financial system. And in order to understand that, you have to learn a little bit about how LIBOR is calculated or was calculated. So the way it happened, there were 16 leading banks. And this agency will call, well, not exactly call, but essentially call these leading banks and ask them about what is the interest rate that they are willing to pay if they were to borrow money right then for short-term purpose, right? So these banks will give the what they think is the interest rate, and this agency will then remove the top quartile, bottom quartile, take the 50%, average it out, and that becomes LIBOR, right? In the sense, like what banks are telling you about interest rate is can be taken as a good subjective measure of what the overall financial health of the market is, because if the interest rate goes up or goes down depends a lot on how overall all the companies are doing, right? So what was found that these banks are not actually reporting the LIBOR rates truthfully, that there's some manipulation going on. And so there was a multi-year investigation, after which in 2012, Barclays Bank had to pay about $200 million in fine for their role in LIBOR scandal. In 2015, Deutsche Bank agreed to pay $2.5 billion for their role. And in between these, there are a whole bunch of banks that were in that got that were found guilty of manipulating the rates, right? So Bank of America, UBS, RBS, Royal Bank of Scotland, that is JP Morgan Chase, all of them were at some point found guilty in playing a hand in this, right? So a total of about $6 billion fines were paid to settle LIBOR cases. That's a lot of money, right? And you might be wondering why I'm talking about this is because it's interesting to know how this happened. And it's kind of funny and it's kind of sad that all of this happened in things like online chat room. So this is a transcript of a chat room that CFTC released. It was conveniently called the cartel. And this is essentially, I'm not sure if you can read it clearly, but it's a conversation between LIBOR rate submitters for banks and traders in the banks. Generally, the submitters should not be talking to traders who are trading on the currencies, but hey, they were not just talking, they were doing a lot more than talking, right? So if you look at this conversation here, there's a trader asking if the LIBOR rates will be higher tomorrow, and the submitter says it shouldn't be, but trader says that, hey, we always need higher LIBOR rates, and the submitter says, hey, I'll do my best, right? The previous conversation before that is also, it's a long chat, but essentially the LIBOR rate submitter is asking people whether they want higher LIBOR rates or lower LIBOR rates tomorrow, and maybe he can do something about it, right? So this is sad, and this is hilarious at the same time, but it's also something that we should be able to prevent, detect, and prevent, right? And that's where our team comes into play. We try to kind of take all of this communication data and try to make a sense of what's going on in this data, right? So on the left side is all the different communication you can communication data you can see, chat, email, IM, social media transcript, market data, all the stuff. We take all of that and feed into the system. On the right are the people who are interested in finding out what's going on in this data. And in the middle is the system that we run on Mesos that essentially tries to figure out or make some sense of what's going on, right? So in order to kind of understand what the underlying system looks like, I'm going to walk over three major workloads that we have, or three major services that we provide to our customers. The first one is a complex event processing system, right? So I'll take an example of an email. Email flows in. We have a bunch of policies. We look at every email that's generated in our system. We see if that email is violating any of the policies or not. And based on the outcome of our complex event processing system, we say whether that email should be blocked from sending. So we can do that, especially for the emails being generated in the terminal, because we control the whole communication path in there. So if the email blocks a policy, we actually block the email from being sent out. We also have the option of warning the user that, hey, you might be violating some policy. If you still want to go ahead and send it, please do. But it's a violation. And obviously, the case where there's nothing wrong in the email, we just let it go through, right? So that's one. This processing tends to be very CPU bound. It's obviously pseudo real time, very low latency processing, because it's not just for email, for IMs also. So the moment you type an IM message, before it's actually displayed in the system, it goes through our infrastructure to do all kinds of checks and send back the and that allows it or doesn't allow it. So before it gets displayed to the other side of your IM conversation, it has to go through all this processing. So it has to be low latency. Right? Other thing that we do provide is We take these emails and we, or all of, not just emails, but all the data, and we index it, right? So then if, how this helps our customers is then they can go back, look at their data if something happens. If something has happened, they can go back and look at their data and figure out what actually happened. So it kind of helps them do e-discovery on their data. Now, the workload tends to be very distributed. It's an indexing and search system, so it can span. It can benefit from running in many machines. So it tends to be very distributed, and typically tend to be memory hog. So it will take as much memory as you throw at it. More the memory, the better it performs. Third major thing that we do is we take all of this communication data, we take all of the results of our compliance checking system or complex event processing system, we take all the indices that we have, and we provide a way for our customers to run reports and analytics on this data, right? So these jobs tend to be ad hoc. So what that means is most of the time people really don't run a lot of reports and analytics on it. But when they do, that can lead to, like, a reporting job can lead to an extraction can be multiple terabytes. So that requires a lot of I/O as well, right? So, and analytics jobs obviously tend to be CPU bound. Right? So overall, at a very high level, we have the kind of jobs that are CPU bound, jobs that are memory bound, jobs that can benefit from running in large clusters, obviously I/O bound jobs, and things that run all the time, and things that come up and go down as needed, so on-demand jobs as well, right? Now, before Mesos came along, this was the picture of our cluster, right? And you'll see this picture probably in many presentations today. We essentially take our machines, we took our machines, we divided them in, statically partitioned them into, say, hey, that's my complex event processing system, that's my reporting and analytics system, then that's my tech search system, right? And if you look at it, like the complex event processing machines, they tend to be completely lit up during market hours because that's where most of the communication, most of the conversations are happening. So these systems are really loaded during market hours. The analytics and reporting system, they tend to be idle most of the time till they are not. So if some customer runs a big extraction job, it will take up all the machine that's available and even more. And then obviously the tech search systems, they like, give me as much machines as possible, right? So this is how we ran. And most of the time we are juggling between these machines to say, hey, give resource to one, take resource from the other, and that doesn't quite work out. So it's really time consuming to scale out a static cluster, or even more scale down a static cluster. So it's a lot of wasted time. You have wasted resource, obviously, because that complex event processing system after market hours, why can't I use it for my reporting system? Or why can't I give it to my tech search system? That's obvious wasted resource. And operational overhead. Over the years, as we acquire more customers, as these systems grow, we keep adding more and more machines to these static clusters, and then you have to manage all of that and run all of that to the point where your developers are doing more operational stuff than actually developing. So obvious problems, right? So that's why we started looking at Mesos. Are these slides flickering? Right. So we started looking at Mesos, and we built our stack, or completely rebuilt our stack to run on Mesos. So at the bottom is our prefabricated hardware. They are pretty homogeneous machines. The only difference is some have SSD-based storage, some have HDD storage, and they are homogeneous at this point because we just bought a bunch of new machines to run Mesos on. On top of these is obviously the Mesos processes. And we also run HDFS, so we statically allocate some machines to HDFS. And there's a reason for doing that, I'll get to that. And we essentially build a service discovery layer on top of this. And the requirements, I'm gonna talk a little bit more about what we had to do for this, to modify the out-of-box service discovery to make it work with our environment and what the requirements are. obviously, on top of this is all the frameworks. So at this point, we're running Marathon, we're running Kronos, we're running Storm. And on top of this is our core infrastructure pieces that we call the data pipeline that runs on top of this stack. So we had we implemented a monitoring stack to monitor all the application that's run on the stack. And I'll get into the details of that. We run Kafka, we run some processing topologies, and Acumulo. Acumulo is a database, for those of you who are not familiar, that's on top of HDFS. But it has some interesting characteristics and properties that we really like, and that's why we use Acumulo. So this becomes like a ingest and outgress point for the data that comes in. So all the data that comes into a system goes into Kafka, and then there's a system that sends back the result of the processing to the customer, back to the client, right? Obviously, we have a service discovery layer. Sorry, we have the REST API layer on top of it that applications can then use and work on. So this is what the stack kind of looks like. Pretty similar to the complex system slide that Neha had in her keynote this morning. But so I'm going to go a little bit more into what we had to do and the stuff that we had to build on top to make all of this work. And first of the first thing that we had to think about is service discovery. So we looked at, I'm not sure if this is Mesosphere implementation or Airbnb implementation. Brendan might be better at knowing that. But essentially how this worked is, if you have anything running on Marathon, you essentially have a way of discovering those services. So you deploy a service in Marathon. Marathon gives you a globally unique port, and then a way to map those ports to the machine that the application is running on and the actual port that the application is running on, right? So what this implementation does is, there's a script called the proxy bridge, HA proxy bridge. And what it does is goes to Marathon, asks Marathon about the status of the cluster, what are the applications running, which ports they are running, which machines they are running. And it generates a HA proxy configuration, which maps like the globally unique port of the application with the actual instance port that the application is running on and the host that it's running on. Right? And then it generates a configuration file for HAProxy and reloads HAProxy. Right? So now if service one in this slave wants to talk to service two, which is running on the other slave, all the service one needs to know is, what is the globally unique port that the service is running on? And then talk to HAProxy on the local host on talking through the global port, and then the HAProxy redirects to where the actual service two is running. So there are a few enhancements that you need to we needed to make in order to make this work with our system. One is, it only worked for Marathon. We had other frameworks too, and it would have been good if there was a service discovery mechanism that worked across all of these frameworks. Only supported at that time only single instance of Marathon, so we had to modify to make it work with multiple instances. There's another thing is, like, when in our cluster, although it's a Mesos cluster, we also kind of share or run some static services on the same cluster. So there was, like, we had a need to kind of find out or discover services that were running, sharing the same machines, but not necessarily running on Mesos. So we needed something, some enhancement in the service discovery to make that happen. Right. Other question is, like, how do clients themselves find what is the globally unique port that Marathon has assigned, right? So there's something needed there. And one of the big things is, now you have these Mesos cluster, which has some stuff running on Mesos, some static, but there are these clients that are outside of this cluster. So how do they find the applications within this cluster, right? So these are the things that we had to think about. So what we did was, we essentially rewrote the proxy bridge to work with multiple instances of Marathon, static services, like in this case HDFS or whatever. And so as long as any of these services offer a REST endpoint for the proxy bridge to go and talk and get where it's running, our proxy bridge script works with it. So we do that. So now it runs across, with multiple instances, different kinds of services, and it essentially does the same thing. Talks to all of these services and regenerates a HAProxy configuration file, right? We also implemented two REST endpoints for service discovery. So there's a Python endpoint and there's a REST endpoint. What the idea of doing this is to answer questions like, how does service one, in case wants to talk to service two, how does service one know what global port Marathon has assigned to service two, right? So in this case, we went with the idea that anything that runs on our cluster will have a very predictable naming scheme. So as long as a client, if you want to find a service, all you needed to know is what's the name of that service. And then you can go to the Python endpoint and say, hey, give me the port, or the globally unique port for this service name. So this endpoint gives you that, then you talk to HAProxy on that global unique port, and then it works the way it does for the rest of the things, right? The second question about how do clients outside of this cluster access services here? So let's say in this case, service three wants to talk, there's a client outside wants to talk to service three, which is running on this slave. So what we do is we publish our REST endpoints and Python endpoints, the machine they are running it into an internal DNS system. And now there's a client that wants to talk to these services, just goes to the DNS to find out where's the REST endpoint, talks to the REST endpoint to find where the HAProxy is, then goes to HAProxy, and then gets redirected to service three, right? So that's how we do service. So this kind of answers all the needs that we have with service discovery. We didn't go specifically with Mesos DNS. It's a great solution. But there was a requirement that we were sharing. Since we were sharing these machines with non-Mesos services as well, we needed something that kind of worked uniformly across everything. Next thing that we had to think about was monitoring applications. And these are the applications that's running on Mesos, right? So typically you have an instance of application that you scale, and when you scale, it goes across multiple machines. The application at any point can move depending if the machine goes down, if the resources go away, whatnot, right? So the application can be running in a lot of machines. Now, Mesos provides, obviously has the, you can go to Mesos UI, click on your application sandbox, see the standard out, see the standard error, see all the log files that's being generated. But that's good for when you have one instance of the application. When you have 15 instances, you really don't want to do that. Really when you have a production problem, you really don't want to go to each of the instances and click and see what's going on, right? So one of the things that we needed was a way to aggregate logs across multiple instances of the applications running in our cluster. Second thing is we wanted to have an easy way for applications to publish their statistics to a centralized place. So application writer only has to worry about just publishing or throwing out statistics, and the infrastructure takes care of centralizing these statistics so they can go and take a look at it and see what's going on, track the application metrics. Third thing, obviously, is alerting. If somebody is deploying an application, they need to be alerted when something goes wrong with their application. So the way we did that is we essentially provision our Mesos slaves with a bunch of infrastructure services, right? So we seed our Mesos slaves with a log shipper service. What it does is it periodically goes to Mesos master and says, hey, give me all the sandboxes or all the applications that are running on this machine. Right. Then it goes to each machine's sandbox and figures out what are the different log files standard out for that application and grabs all of that information. You can also, as an application deployer, have any file that you want to collect. You just have to specify in your application configuration file, and the log shipper knows how to read that and do the right thing. Right? So it does that. And then it aggregates all the applications that are running in a machine and sends it to a Kafka. This Kafka cluster is also running in the same Mesos cluster as well. So it's all inside the Mesos cluster. And then there's an Elk stack which reads off data from Kafka, sends it to Elasticsearch, and there's a Kibana where you can have an aggregated view of your logs. Next thing is statistics, right? So each of these slave machines are, as Ben said, agent machines, also have a stats tree running. And it runs on a known port, known UDP port, so all an application has to do in order to publish metrics and stats is to just throw stats to StatsD on localhost. It grabs all of that, puts it on InfluxDB, and then as an application writer, there's a Grafana running on the cluster. You can just go to Grafana and plot all the interesting colorful graphs that you want, right? Same thing we do, we also collect machine level information. So that's CollectD comes into play. That also pumps the same information to InfluxDB. And then finally, in order to like complete the picture, there's a Rayman instance running which reads the data off InfluxDB, and you can configure the Rayman to say what are the metrics or what are the parameters you want to generate alerts on. It takes all of this and pipes it to our alerting system. That alerting system then goes to our data center folks, our DevOps folks, who then can wake up the programmer who's responsible for the app. So some guy, poor guy, gets woken up middle of the night, right? And now this guy can go look at Grafana, look at Kibana, and then just figure out what's going on across, right? There's one interesting thing that we'd like to implement, we have been talking about, is having log aggregation through a UI is a good thing, but it's even better if you have like a log aggregation over command line. Right, so we've talked multiple times about, and we'll implement it, is to have like a command line tool which reads data from our Kafka log stream and then gives you ability to grab, pipe, cut, do whatever you want with that log. So that'll be good to have for us. Lastly, access control. It doesn't exist right now, but so most of the applications that we are deploying right now, we deploy over Marathon. So we run Kafka through Marathon, we run Acumulo through Marathon, we run our policy engines through Marathon, and it works fairly well, right? But one thing that Marathon was implemented for was system admins to deploy applications on behalf of user and make changes on behalf of user. It wasn't meant for like a platform where people can just deploy their applications and do stuff. And so what we wanted was, we wanted to give a little more power to our users. We wanted them to be able to deploy their application, play with it, do whatever they want with their applications without having to go to somebody to do it on their behalf, right? But we really wanted to prevent our core services. So remember, we have Kafka running here, we have Acumulo running here, that forms our core infrastructure piece. We really wanted to like prevent accidents from bringing these services down, right? So a user deploys an application, goes to Marathon UI, instead of destroying their application, they destroy Kafka and then, or worse, Zookeeper, and then everything falls apart, right? So we wanted to prevent that from happening. We also wanted to obviously prevent one user from stepping on other users' toes as well. So we kind of did a simple solution for this. We took Marathon. Marathon comes with a password-based authentication with SSL enabled, so we enabled that on Marathon. So what that essentially prevented is now not every user can go to Marathon and do stuff with Marathon. What we do is we also put a reverse proxy in front of Marathon and a key store. So now as a user, you don't interact with Marathon, but you interact with this reverse proxy. And let's say you want to deploy an application. You talk to this reverse proxy and say, hey, deploy, launch this application on my behalf. This reverse proxy then generates a key for that application or that user and stores that key in this key store, right? And then does whatever operation needs to be done. So it launches the application on behalf of user and returns back this key to the user. Now, if you are using our command line launcher, it will just display you the key that you can use later to modify your application or update your application. If you are using a browser to launch our application, it just sets the key in as your browser cookie. So next time you go to Marathon, it does the right thing. Next time you go to reverse proxy, it does the right thing. So now if you want to update your application, all you need to say, hey, update my application and use this app key. The reverse proxy checks whether this app key has access to that application or not, performs the operation and returns success or failure, right? So this kind of is a very simple implementation. It's not meant to be super secure or it was not meant to prevent any kind of hacking. This was just meant to make our lives slightly easier or smoother, right? And we found a second benefit of this. So if you remember our stack, we had a storm running up there with everything else. So we intend to use this for like deploying topologies. So we provide Storm as an infrastructure support, an infrastructure piece, and then we allow users to deploy their own topologies. So this will essentially reverse proxy will allow them to deploy Storm topologies as well without having to run on each other's foot. So that was pretty much those were the three big things that we had to implement. And obviously, we've been working this system for about a year. So in between, we went over different technologies. There's so much technology out there. So for service discovery, we looked at the HAProxy bridge. We looked at Bamboo. And there's a lot of time that we spent figuring out what's the right technology is, right? But we learned a few lessons along the way. So first lesson, and we spoke to Mesosphere guys as well, is to protect your Zookeeper cluster. We heard that, we took a note down of protecting Zookeeper cluster, and then we shot ourselves. So we did some right things. So we had separate Mesos Zookeeper and separate application Zookeeper. But when we had first we built our dev cluster, and then we started building our production cluster, and there was some communication open, so the production Zookeeper started talking to the dev Zookeeper. So the whole dev system went down, and we spent 2 days figuring out what the hell is going on, right? So protect Zookeeper, that's the bottom line. This could be controversial. We looked at Mesos, and we got excited. We said, hey, it's a great thing, we'll run everything on Mesos. So the first instance of this, we ran HDFS on Mesos. So HDFS came up, and then HDFS went down. Name node came up, name node disappeared. And that kind of like wasted a lot of our time, right? And then we spoke to Mesosphere folks, and it seemed like HDFS Mesos is the right solution to go with. And that's our medium-term plan to move to HDFS Mesos. But in the meantime, we essentially removed our HDFS from Mesos, and we run a static instance of HDFS. Understand a few things like backoff factor in Marathon. There's a GitHub ticket for that. But essentially, what happens is Marathon has this concept of backoff factor. Is when your application is failing, it'll try to restart, and it'll exponentially back off when the application keeps failing, so you don't keep filling up your sandboxes and stuff like that. However, it doesn't really work when your application starts. So Mesos executor says the application actually started successfully, but what could happen is your application is doing some initialization. For instance, it's connecting to some DB and it cannot connect to the DB and it fails. Now, in Marathon has no way of knowing that happened. So at that point, it thinks that the application was running fine and it went down, so it restarts the application. So you get into this loop where the application keeps going up, going down, going up, going down. And if you have multiple instances of it, it can happen quickly, and it can fill up all the sandboxes. So the next thing is to clean up sandboxes periodically, right? It'll create problems for you. So in our dev clusters, we clean up sandboxes once a week, and in production cluster, we do it like every half a day or something like that, right? Another controversial, build a monitoring infrastructure. Now, everybody builds their own monitoring infrastructure. I didn't want to, but I need to, right? If I want to open the system up for the users, I need to be able to give them a monitoring infrastructure that they can rely on. Otherwise, they're going to build their own monitoring infrastructure. So I think there are a few talks in this conference. Datadog is talking about how to monitor Mesos and stuff like that. It'll be good to hear their solution. If there's something much better, I'm willing to just swap this out and use, and not having to maintain one more piece of infrastructure. Run multiple clusters. I say that because our philosophy with our Mesos cluster always was not to build an generic infrastructure, but build an infrastructure that serves a business need. So as the first thing that we wanted to do was to run complex event processing system in production, right? That was our goal outright. So what we wanted to do is build a cluster, and if we had one cluster which we are developing, and we want to bring onboard our users as well to use the cluster, we really don't have flexibility to make any changes in the cluster. Specifically, when you are going through initial iterations where you'll inevitably break your cluster, you'll bring things down, you'll have very, very annoyed users. So the philosophy that we use for that is we built multiple clusters. So we had multiple dev clusters, multiple production cluster, so the users are always working on a stable cluster while the developers are destroying the other cluster and fixing it, right? So that's something to think about. Finally, what we found is that Mesos is really, really stable. A year ago when I came to MesosCon, I looked at all the presentations and I thought, it'll be really cool to have a system like this. A year out, we have a system like this. And most of the problems that we've found and we've fixed is things that we built on top of it. Mesos has been a very, very stable system. And you guys are responsible, the community is responsible for it. So thank you very much for that. That's pretty much it. We are hiring. We are in the best city in the world, right? Here's the contact link. If you're interested, come talk to me. There are a few other folks from Bloomberg you can talk to. We are the best people, we are in the best city in the world, and we are also very welcoming. So come, it's New York City after all. All right. That's all I had. If you guys have any questions, I'm happy to answer anything. Yeah. Yes, we did. And I don't remember the reason why we went against it. I think at that time, Consul had the requirement that every application need to be modified to learn or know about Consul. And that was the reason why we didn't go with Consul at that point. Yeah, so the question is whether we are running bare metal or virtual machines, it's bare metal. Yeah. I don't know. So one big application right now is running on a production cluster that obviously comprises of multiple services. But we have plans of moving more and more application as we get more and more confidence in our ability to keep this cluster up and running and working all the time. Yeah. So the question is if we build for monitoring infrastructure, if we build this on every Mesos slave, and yes, because every Mesos slave needs certain services in order to grab all the logs, all the statistics, and ship it somewhere else. So yeah, this is the picture inside every Mesos slave, whether it's running application or whether it's running just Kafka or whatever. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's something we wrote. Yeah. Yep. Sorry? So partly we've automated parts of it using Chef. A lot of it is duct tape. We are getting there. When you want to build a system like that, automation is really the last thing you want to work on when it's the first thing you should be working on. So, yeah. Say that again? So the question is, if co-located tasks on the same slave interfere with each other? We haven't seen problems where one application in some way mugs with other application on the same slave. We have obviously seen issues where one application wants to take up all the resources on that slave. So I think we have had one problem where Kronos decided to use everything and that was available in the cluster. But not in the sense that we have not seen or we haven't run the kind of load where one application's like use of CPU cache bothers the performance of other application, if that's what you mean. So that's a subjective measure in my head currently. So I feel that the amount of time that it used to take for our developers to deploy new application and try new application, that time has reduced significantly. I haven't measured that, frankly. It's just a subjective feeling at this point. The goal is to get this up and running as quickly as possible, then collect those statistics and get more money to build more cluster. So. Yeah. As running as what? I think they all run as Ubuntu user at this point. Yeah. So, but the difference for us is that's why we built it as a platform for one team and not platform for company. So we could tell our users to, hey, just play nice, because we still have the power to boot you off if you do something nasty. But yeah, that's why we wanted to kind of scope down the problem, really, right? If you start building of like a generic Mesos cluster that runs all your data center across the whole world, you have to like solve problems at a really big scale. And we wanted to avoid running into those issues. Yeah. Yeah. What do we use for indexing? Solr, Lucene, mostly Lucene. Any other questions? Yep. A what? I'm not sure I understand you, but we can talk about it afterwards. Yeah. All right, cool. Thank you, guys.